to everyone. On behalf of Indian Association for Veterinary Dermatology and Intas Pharmaceuticals, I welcome all of you for this show. Recent days, we started having a lot of infectious diseases like LSD, which is affecting the skin of the bovines. All over India, we have got a lot of issues, and a lot of skin problem has occurred in bovines. So we thought of going for proper treatment and specialists say about it, like that we want to have a more clarification in that. So we thought of having one lecture in the webinar lecture about the bovine dermatological disorder management, pharmacotherapeutic management of bovine dermatological disorder with the right speaker. We are having a very good speaker with us. I welcome Dr. Sridhar, who is a professor and head of Department of Pharmacology and Toxicology from Shimoga Veterinary College. I welcome you, sir, for the show. And I know he is a very great expert in bovine, particularly in pharmacology. He can easily explain everything to us for the management, pharmacotherapeutic management of bovine dermatological disorders. I also welcome our Amanjo Singh and Dr. Nitin Bhatia for the show. And I request Dr. Nitin Bhatia to introduce our speaker to the audience. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for giving me a chance to introduce a wonderful person. We have with us Dr. N.B. Sridhar. N.B. Sridhar is currently working as professor and head Department of Veterinary Pharmacology and Toxicology at Shimoga Veterinary College. I know him personally since not many years. He is also the principal investigator and head for Obscure Disease Research and Center. I have consistently seen him working on toxicology, weeds, whatever is pharmacologically correlative with clinical, because in the starting of his career, he has been a field vet. So he has been a graduate from Dharwad in 1990 and postgraduate from IVRI in 93 and PhD from Bangalore, after which he has joined as a VO in Department of Animal Husbandry, Karnataka, and later on shifted himself to the college. He has served as a major advisor for 26 MBS students and 6 PhD students. I have also seen him as a person who tries to take the information from college down to the field. He has written 4 books, number of articles on newspapers for the benefit of farmers. So a real pharmacologist who has tried to make practicality reach on to the farm level. So we have pleasure in inviting Dr. N.B. Sridhar, who is a pharmacologist and who would like to brief us on the pharmacotherapeutic management of bovine dermatological disorders. Over to Dr. Sridhar for the next insight into bovine dermatology.
Thank you very much, sir. I just share the screen. I'm unable to. Just 1 minute. I want to share the PowerPoint. Stop presenting. So just I will share the PowerPoint. Start sharing. Just 10 minutes. Okay. I'm not getting the presentation. Just
it came and it went.
Yeah, it came.
Yeah, 3 minutes back it came.
Okay. Now it is coming.
Yes, coming.
Okay.
Just make it full screen.
Yes,
yeah, full screen, sir.
Okay. Now it's full screen, sir.
Done. Yeah. All done. Yes.
So thank you very much, Dr. Nitin Bhatia, for your nice introduction, and also Dr. Balasubramanian, sir, for giving me the opportunity to interact with the veterinarians of the India about the pharmacotherapeutic management of the bovine dermatological disorders. So I was very enthusiastic to participate in the especially the AVD and the INTAS oriented this particularly webinar to share my experiences. So yes, it's very appreciable that a separate association is made for the bovine dermatological disorders, especially the animal dermatological disorders, which are highly neglected one. And of course, we need to concentrate very much because it is said that there is about 10% loss is there to the economics of from the dairy, because whenever there is a dermatological disorders, then the cattle production and reproduction also goes down. So with this appreciation to the association and also the INTAS Pharmaceuticals in which I was associated with so many years, probably about 30 years when I was a veterinarian in the field as the veterinary officer, and later also as a faculty in the Karnataka Veterinary Animal and Fishery Sciences, so university. So I will go through my topics like this. Then especially the initially I will try to focus a very brief, especially on the dermatological disorders and their different causes and the treatment there only. Then yes, we know, everybody know about the dermatitis is caused by so many etiologies, and also the it is classified as bacterial, fungal, parasitic, viral, immunological, and also the congenital, environmental, and some of the dermatitis are associated with the nutritional deficiencies or nutritional excess also. Then some of the dermatological disorders are also induced due to the neoplasma and also the non-neoplastic in growth, and many are unclassified and they are put in the category of the miscellaneous skin dermatitis. So we will go by the individual category, like the bacterial skin disease, and there is a big list, like the so many classifications are there, and there is a very big list, like the impetigo, folliculitis, furunculosis, then ulcerative lymphangitis, porinobacterium, pseudotuberculosis, granuloma, so many dermatophilosis, actinomycosis, then actinobacillosis, clostridial cellulitis, and of course the Farsi, abscess, cellulitis, bacterial pseudomycetoma, and so many causes are there, so many varieties are there, but we are unable to diagnose them properly and use a suitable antimicrobial agent to combat the diseases there. Of course, with all this, especially in the skin disease, in the small animal, it's a very challenging and it's very difficult to cure the skin disorders. So the same holds good for the large animal also. So, but it is, of course, as on date, the very less emphasis is given on the dermatological disorders in large animal, and many times only ivermectin treatment will make the treatment for the universal treatment for everything, and end up with the unresponsiveness of the particular treatment, this thing. So I am going through varieties of the diseases. Yes, of course, you may get confused, but within the available time of 45 minutes, I will try to cover almost all the diseases, especially skin disorders, which are coming to the cattle. So first is the impetigo, means the Latin, it is called as the attack or scabby eruption. It's a superficial pustular dermatitis and very commonly caused by the staph aureus. So you may be knowing that the staph aureus is a causative agent for varieties of the mastitis, especially the acute mastitis in case of the cattle, and it is causing the disease due to the trauma, moisture, and stress of the parturition. Of course, the dairy breeds and the lactating females, because a lot of these nutrients are drained in the milk and they become very much susceptible, and we can see the lesions on the udder, teats, ventral abdomen, medial thighs, vulva, perineum, and the ventral tail. So the pharmacological treatment is always, it is streptomycin or the or any other antibiotic after culture and sensitivity pattern, because the bacterial sensitivity pattern changes from each area, and it's also depending upon the regional use of the antimicrobial agent. So whenever such incidences occurs, you can see that such type of the diseases are there, and impetigo, sometimes it is always affecting the udder, then also thighs, and also sometimes the cracks on this particular teat also. Many times this is being confused with that of the boy in herpes malmilitis, but I will come to the later, the viral cause of the dermatitis is there separately we are going to be. So any antibiotic which is diagnosed as particularly if you have to do the CNS if possible, then you can do. The second one is the folliculitis, or it is also called that as the hair follicle inflammation, or it is also known as the furunculosis, folliculitis or the furunculosis. And the particularly this is caused by the two important microorganisms. The one is the staph and the staphylococcus hicus. And the predisposing factors are whenever there is a more moisture and trauma, then lesions will be, especially the lot of lesions will be there. And we need to especially diagnose this thing based on the symptoms, like the lesions will be seen in the rump, tail and perineum, and also the distal limbs, neck and face. So the treatment, of course, it is penicillins, among the penicillins only, depending upon the culture and sensitivity, we may need to go for the broad spectrum penicillins or the methicillin resistant penicillins also. But nowadays it is very well responding to the cephalosporins with a particularly the proper doses very much required. So you can see here, many times we will get confused with that of the lumpy skin disease, but the multiple tufted papules and annular areas of the crustacean, then the alopecia and ulcerations are there. Many times the multiple annular crests of the face and neck and shoulder will be seen. So hence you one need to differentiate. And this is also another furunculosis which is caused by the staphylococcus organisms. There is a plague with the draining tracts and ulceration on the caudolateral aspect of the pastern is there. And here also you can see that the multiple annular crests on the base of the tail. So and one need to diagnose this particular thing. And of course the ulcerative lymphangitis, so it is a bacterial infection of the cutaneous lymphatics are involved here. Then it is caused by so many microorganisms, by the especially Corynebacterium, pseudotuberculosis, staph aureus, hemolytic streptococcus, etc. So the lesions are typically unilateral. So unilateral, so that you need to see, that you need to study the lesion several times, and we need to get ourselves very much acquainted with that of the dermatological disorder. So what is a line of treatment means? You have to lance it and drain external abscess as a, and we have to need to treat it as a abscess, and long term antimicrobial therapy for the limb infection is there. Then the sometimes whenever there is a Corynebacterium is there, then we need to especially you need to select a particular antimicrobial agent. And a very important thing is the fly control. That's also very important. Then sometimes the disease, especially you can see that this is a ulcerative, especially granulomatous disease, large ulcerated nodule is there, and it is oozing always. So one need to open this thing and make it a drainage for this, so that the disease will be cured very fast. Then, yes, here also on the legs, so many lesions will be present, which are always having the oozing in nature. Hence, one need to take care of these lesions with a suitable antimicrobial agent, and also the different type of the treatments which are supporting the dermatitis. I am going to tell it later. So another thing which is caused by the disease, so the dermatophyllosis, you know that dermatophyllosis, it is also called as the streptothricosis or rain root or rain scab. It's a very common skin diseases by the Dermatophyllus congolensis. So this is also very difficult to treat, and this is many times complicated by the tick bite insects, then also the prickly vegetation. And when the animals are exposed to sunlight or the UV light, it is getting very much exaggerated. So it is a zoonotic important disease. So whenever we are handling the skin disorders, always wear a proper gloving and protective clothing also, or else these particular lesions will be transmitting from the animal to the human being. And also the lesions are very much distributed to the dorsum, lump and brisket, axillae, groin, face and pinnae, then also the distal legs, udder and teats. So here what you call as the varieties of the tufted papules and pustules are there, and they become very large in nature. The hair follicles are also involved, and it's called as the paint brush because it is looking like a paint brush. So there is no standard treatment protocols, but based on cultural sensitivity, many times this is somewhat very difficult to treat, and we need to conduct the cultural sensitivity and treat. Here you can see the multiple thick crests over the back, rump, tail, and perineum. So this is like a honeycomb, and one need to diagnose this very properly, the dermatophyllosis. Multiple bacterial origin is there, then one need to treat it very properly. So this is also the another dermatophyllosis region. Here you can see the generalized crust. And also sometimes they are oozing with the pus and coating ulcers, and outer side the avulsed crust also we can see. And there are multiple crusts, ulcers, alopecia are also there, and sometimes this is looking like a wart lesion also. So these are not the wart lesions, but they are the crusts on perineum, caudal thighs, and also the groin and scrotum associated with the tick infestation. It is complicated by the tick infestation, and one need to treat for that thing also. So here the next disease is the actinomycosis. Of course, everybody know that this is going to cause the lumpy skin disease, but many times it goes unnoticed, and it is caused by the actinomycosis bovis, and also the very rarely, occasionally, actinomycosis israelii. So here one important thing, how it is diagnosed, is the mandible and maxilla. The lesions are very common. That's lumpy skin disease. Everybody can very easily diagnose. It's a firm, variably painful, immovable bony mass. And of course, it is extended to the bone tissue also. So sometimes the nodules are formed, then the treatment is surgical removal, and streptopenicillin course is very much required, along with the administration of potassium iodine orally 5 grams per day about 7 days, or else if you continue it, then there is a toxicity chance are also there. Yes, it's very well differentiated thing. Of course, it's considered as a skin disorder. Yes, sometimes the oozing wound is also there, but this is very typically the lesions of such 1 rupee coin lesions, like the draining tracts will be there, which are present on the udder. So please differentiate this from the regular disease which is affecting the udder also. Then the actinobacillosis, so you know, everybody knows that it is causing the wooden tongue, which is caused by actinobacillus lignarici, and it contaminates variety of the wounds and tufted wounds. Lesions are most commonly seen on the face. Here, the lesions are most commonly seen on the face, especially the cheek, lip, nostril, and eyelid, and head and neck. So the lesions may be varieties of multiple, single, or etc. So it oozes the greenish pus, and of course the treatment, the basic treatment should start with the penicillins, maybe the narrow spectrum penicillins. Later we can go also for the broad spectrum, extended spectrum, depending upon the C&S tests, because this need to be treated with potassium iodide orally about 6 to 10 gram per day for 10 days. Or else the IV sodium iodide, one need to be very careful while administering the sodium iodide, and 10% solution should be made. Especially then very slow IV administration should be done whenever there is a acute cases are there. Especially the dose is 8 gram for 100 gram. It should not exceed this particular thing, or else we will end up with the iodine toxicity, because this here you can see that these are all the lesions which are very similar to that of the actinomycosis, but the lesions are above in the mandibular lesion. Sometimes we are also confused with the horn cancer, and lesions will be ulcerated, crusted, and mass subsequent to the dehorning operations. After also, if it is infected by the actinobacillosis, then it is causing the horn cancer-like lesions. Then opportunistic mycobacterial granuloma. So this is caused by the Mycobacterium canisii. So they may be spread to the thigh and udder, and sometimes it is very difficult to treat such things. And actually, there is no very good treatment for the Mycobacterium in case of the cattle are concerned, but we should at least able to diagnose this particular thing, because this opportunistic mycobacterial granuloma affects after some of the other immunosuppressive disorders, and also multiple papules or nodules on the limb are noticed. So especially in the Streptococcus dermatitis also, very similar lesions are there, but they are responsive to penicillin. Here, if they are unresponsive to the penicillin, then we need to think that they are caused by the mycobacterium. Then the Farsi, of course, many persons have listed or heard about the Farsi. That's the pyogranulomatous disease of the skin and lymphatics caused by the mycobacterium once again, or else it is also caused by the Nocardia and mycobacterium species. So these lesions here are present on the head, neck and shoulder and legs. Of course, many times it is getting confused with the other bacterial diseases also. Then the enlarged and palpable chordate lymphatics and regional lymphopathy are also very common. There is no treatment for the Farsi is concerned, because it is caused by the mycobacterium mainly, followed by the Nocardia. And here you can see that nodular type of the lesions, papules and nodules, and some of which are ulcerated here, are some of the, especially in the abdominal region, thigh regions, everywhere you can get the oozing wound with greenish pus. So the fungal disease, the second category, of course, the bacterial diseases, except this mycobacterium, etc., we can treat it with the suitable antimicrobial agent, whereas the fungal diseases are caused by varieties of the fungus, starting from the dermatophytosis, aspergillosis, malassezia, otitis externa, then this pythiosis. So the general line, now there is what you call as, each disease is not having the separate treatment, but the general line of the treatment is the administration of antifungal agents, especially the application of any antifungal agent, especially the Whitfield's ointment, because it turns to be cheap also. Or else maybe if we go for this treating with that of the miconazole or any azole antifungal, it becomes very costly, so the farmers cannot afford. And coming to the first one, that is the dermatophytosis, it is also called as a very popularly, it is known as the ringworm. Everyone knows it. It is most commonly caused by the trichophoretum, that's the varicosum. So many varieties of the other species, especially the trichophoretum, mentagrophytes, equinum, then microsporum also, both of these are belonging, and M. canis and M. nanum. So these are causing the diseases, especially the face, head and pinnae and rump and perineum, it is affected. And this, especially bovine dermatophytosis, is highly contagious. And the zoonotic disease, one need to have very careful observation about this thing. So of course, this is very difficult to treat antifungal drugs. Of course, the oral antifungal drugs, most of them are not effective orally in case of the ruminants, because the ruminal microflora get them detoxified or metabolized. So there are no very good injectable antifungal drugs are there, but only the thing is the topical application is always recommended. So here you can see that this is dermatophytosis, also known as the ringworm, annular, thick, grayish, and here you can see that the round lesions are there, especially on the facial region, lot of lesions will be there, and it's having some of the itching effect also. Here you can also, you can see that perineum region do contain lot of such lesions. And of course, there is a thick grayish white crust on the flank is there. So human beings are also infected with that particular disease, especially dermatophytosis. So one need to be very careful, especially about this dermatophytosis concern. And the other parasitic disorders, especially the chorioptic mange, sauroptic mange, then sarcoptic mange, then demodectic mange, and also the pediculosis, are the other causes of the parasitic causes of the dermatological disorders in case of the large animals. Yeah, these are all the things. And of course, we have got varieties of the diseases are there, especially the this is the mange, and especially thrombiculosis, dermatophysis, then ticks, fleas, biting fleas, and all these are going to cause lot of disorders. That's the list is very big. Then the parafilariasis, onchosarcoidosis is it's all caused by the different causes, you know. So the different causes are there, and the of course the chorioptic mange is also another mange. In the mange only we have got the varieties of the manges, and the foot mange or the tail mange. So we'll go by in detail, especially the mange. It is caused by the Choreoptis bovis, and very specifically in case of stable, especially stall feed dairy cattle. And mite populations may also be in the winter, it may be more, and the transmission occurs by direct and indirect contact, the animal to animal contact, and also the contact by the other means, indirect contacts, and also very commonly seen on the rump, the tail, perineum, and also the caudomedial thigh. So this is pruritus is also present and mild to intense. Of course, this disease is not a zoonotic important one, whereas the earlier one is a zoonotic. So the drug of choice for the both are the ivermectin or the doramectin with the suitable dose, and can be used to treat, especially in case of mange. Especially the eprinomectin is recently originated, and poron solutions, especially the varieties of the poron, cypermethrin, deltamethrin, and so many porons are useful in this particular disorder. And the important thing to notice that it is not a zoonotic disease. So here you can see that chorioptic mange, especially in the thighs, the lesions will be present, and crusts on the steeds are also present. And of course, the erythema, alopecia, excoriations of the distal leg, etc., are seen. Sometimes the entire the regions, it will be suffering from the alopecia and excoriation. Excoriation part will be seen. And the soroptic mange, it is also called as the body mange, especially the lesions will be shoulder and rump. It is seen in the beef cattle in winter. So many of the animals, of course, affected with the 40% or more part of the body will be affected, and skin become lignified and thickened, and the chronicity. Of course, there is papules, pustules, exudation, crust, etc. And it is not zoonotic, and the treatment with ivermectin, of course, the doramectin, and external application of the deltamethrin, cypermethrin, or poron preparations. But one should see that the drug applied over the body should not be leaked by the animal. And these are the, of course, the mange. One need to diagnose this properly. And we can see that there is a alopecia, erythema, crust, and lignification over the lateral trunk, we can see. Then the sarcoptic mange is also called as the head mange, and it is caused by the Sarcoptus cavii, especially in case of bovines. And one important thing here is the pruritus is very, very intense. So here, one of the important thing to observe is many animals are affected simultaneously. Then the treatment, of course, is sometimes this is also infected by the secondary bacterial infection, that's the Staphylococcus. So the pyoderma is a very common secondary complication, and we need to treat it accordingly to that of the chorioptic mange. And sarcoptic mange is very potential zoonotic important diseases, especially the persons who are working with that of the animals, etc., to be very careful. And here you can see the different type of the lesion, and one should observe the lesions very carefully and do conduct the samples and collect the samples and do conduct the microscopic examinations. So here also you can see that the alopecia, lignification, crusts, and sometimes the human being who is in association with the animal will get the particular type of the lesions. And demodectic mange, of course, everybody know that it is caused by the demodectic mange. This is not a zoonotic disease, and the treatment is as usual with that of the other thing. And the treatment as usual, that's the as that of the other mange. Here you can see the especially skin scraping samples will demonstrate the demodectic mange, and multiple papillas, especially on the brisket region, is the characteristic feature of the demodectic mange. Then the another thing which is parasitic cause is the Staphylococcus filariasis, is caused by the Staphylococcus filaria still SI, and the flies, like the biting flies, like the hematobia, is the intermediate host for this particular organism, and the lesions are like this, especially and the topical application of the trichloroform paste, also sometimes the amitraz or the ivermectin and milbemycin families especially are the useful ivermectins and the milbemycins. So here you can see that the lesions, especially the stephanophilariasis, the erythema, etc., are seen on the other region, and also the alopecia, then erythema and crust lignification of the ventral part of the body is seen. Then the viral origins, so this is very difficult to cure, like this. So many, once again, so you are seeing on the slide that so many diseases are there, like pseudococcus, the bovine papillary stomatitis, herpes mammalitis. Yes, especially the herpes mammalitis is one of the important disease of the buffaloes of India. Then malignant catarrhal fever, bovine viral diarrhea, infectious bovine rhinotracheitis, FMD, and LSD, you know, everybody is knowing very well. Then besnardiosis is also the viral skin diseases. So apart from this one, in case of the other viral diseases like the blue tongue, bovine ephemeral fever, also the dermatological diseases will be there. Then cowpox, bovine spongiform encephalopathy, so, and also the pseudorabies, rinderpest, all these will have the typical lesions on the skin. So we'll go very fast, especially the pseudocowpox caused by the parapox virus, BOVIS2, and most common diseases of the teeth lesions. So the transmission occurs via the contaminations of the skin abrasions and sometimes the wound also. See, here we can see the crusts or the ring or horseshoe shaped lesions are very pathognomonic in its nature, and the udder is often affected. There is no good treatment as it is a viral disease, but application of the ointments containing the varieties of the antiseptics containing chlorhexidine or the other antiseptics, especially the antibiotics, course of antibiotic may also be useful, because it will prevent the secondary bacterial infection. So here you can see that the pseudocopox affect the teats and umbilicated papules, and annular crescentive red crust on the teat will be formed, and here, and also it also affects the multiple crystals, anus and vulva also. So especially these horseshoes type of the red crusts are characteristic of the pseudocopox, especially on the multiple crusted and umbilicated papules on the scrotum are very characteristic. Many times this is being confused with that of the regular cowpox. But here also we can see that umbilical pustules and erythema, hello, it's also called as the Milker nodules, especially on the teat, the lesions will be like this. And bovine this papillary stomatitis caused by the parapox virus, BOVIS1, and transmission occurs via the contamination of the, especially the skin abrasions. So it is also called as the bovine pustular stomatitis. It is a highly zoonotic disease, and it is called as the Milker's nodule or Farmad pox. And the treatment is very, very symptomatic. Here you can see the lesions are on the muzzle and also on the teats. Especially the teat lesions always make us to confuse with that of the other diseases of the teat, including the bovine herpes mammalitis 1. So here you can see that the orange papillomatous lesions are on the mouth, and it is also highly zoonotic. Then pustular lesions on the fingers will be seen. Then another important disease, with a very common disease in case of the buffaloes, is bovine herpes virus 2. Then it is caused by the contact and insect vectors also, whereas it's occurring in the lactating cattle and the Indian buffaloes and heifers. They are very susceptible and transmitted, especially in case of summer and also during the calving seasons. And most cattle show no signs of the systemic illness, but the lesions will be confined to teat only and involve almost all the teats, and sometimes it is circumferential also. So the disease is typically sudden onset with swollen, very hard teats, and The lot of research papers are there on this particular thing. Irregular shaped vesicles may be seen. Later, they get sloughed off and ulcerations are very commonly noticed. Here are, then the lesions are very, very painful. The buffaloes will never allow to milk and always they kick, but it is not zoonotic. And varieties of the treatments are suggested, like broad spectrum antibiotics, non-NSAIDs, application of iodophore ointment, and only early stages they are very effective. Once the gangrenous ring is formed, necrotic ring is formed, then it is there is no use. And apart from this one, the acyclovir oral or ointment in the initial stage is also helpful. So you may be seeing this, especially the herpes mammalitis. Irregularly shaped vesicles on the teeth are seen, then many times they are having the crusted ulcers, especially on the teeth. So in case of buffaloes, I think many of the veterinarians who have participated in seminar, particularly they might have seen such black necrotic spot initially on one of the teeth, then there is a circumscribed necrosis will occur, then the necrotic ring will be formed, later it will follow this particular thing, and after one teeth falls off, it will also spread to the another teeth. Nowadays, it's beyond doubt, it's proved that it is due to the bovine herpes mammalitis 2 virus. Then here also you can see, so this is initial stages, later the circumscribed ring is formed, later progression of the disease will be seen by the particular black necrotic patch and the teeth will fall off. So this causes a lot of economical loss to the farmer, and many times the both teeth are also will be fall off. And sometimes the ethnoveterinary treatment are there. Of course, recently I published one paper on this thing. You can also use the acyclovir injection and also lithium antimony thiamilate can also be used. The exact mechanism, how they are going to act is not known, but especially acyclovir is an anti-herpes virus, very specifically one we can use, but it causes little toxicity. But when compared to the economic importance, one need to offer that particular thing. And lumpy skin disease, I will not go in detail. Of course, the treatment is NSAIDs, antibiotics, etc. But the initial clinical signs, etc., everybody knows, I think everybody knows that disease transmitted by the biting fly and also the transmission, etc. The characteristic lesions are seen everywhere and the body, and also small papules and ulcerated nodules are there. Everybody is very well familiar with that of the this lumpy skin disease or virus and its infections. So these are all the lesions, especially on the muzzles, then especially on the nose regions, we can see varieties of the lesions. Usually the bovines are affected, but the buffaloes are also affected very commonly. And recently, a few of the papers say that this is also zoonotic. And we have seen that the persons handling with that of the LSD do get the similar type of the infections. So this is also the lumpy skin disease lesion, and one should not confuse with that of the pseudo rabies. Similar type of the lesions will be there, but it is superficial. Then the another treatment, the many times the farmers ask what we can do. Here we can suggest that especially the we have used this particular combination. We cannot prescribe the farmers with the ointment because entire disease, entire skin is affected, and it causes really this thing. The economically, it cannot be borne by the farmer. So the neem leaf and the osimum sanctum leaves, the garlic bulbs, then curcuma longa about 100 gram each, then this neem oil in 1 liter, and this should be painted on the body of the animal. Then we have seen that a very good healing is there, especially this is a this bullet with that of the before treatment. Then yes, it was having the this type of the ulcer, these nodules, but the especially it happens that whenever there is a costly bullock is there, the farmer, if he loses the hide of this animal, the value will be drastically lower. So after treatment, you can see that this is very nicely healed and with very cheap also. That also we have to see. And the another in one or two other type of the especially experimental protocols, these are all the lesions healed, especially by this particular ethnoveterinary treatment. So in lumpy skin disease, ulcerated nodules on the teeth and face also, they are noticed. So the protozoan skin diseases, especially the basnoidiosis, sarcocystiosis, then thyliariasis and trips, all these there will be lesions. So basnoidiosis is also known as the globidiosis, then basnotia, basnotoid is the causative agent. And the disease is most common in the summer and there is no specific lesions. And we will see what are all the lesions here, the basnoidiosis, edema, erythema, crusting and alopecia of the leg. And the scrotum also, we can see that the edema of the scrotum and it is having the thickening. The skin is very much affected and thickened and becomes very unresponsive to the treatment, basnoidiosis. So some of the immunological skin diseases are like the urticaria, cutaneous adverse drug reaction, alopecia areata, bone this exfoliative erythroderma, and varieties of the food hypersensitivity. Yes, we will come to that particular food hypersensitivity, then insect hypersensitivity, toxic epidermal necrosis or the necrolysis and vesicularities are there. Then urticaria, it's also called as the hive, very rarely reported, but the pruritic, very highly itching the disease, the animal rubs its hide over our skin, especially against the very sharp objects. So varieties of the causes are there. Of course, the insect bite, infections, systemic medications, then the biologicals, especially the physical trauma, and all this milk allergy, especially the animal will be allergic to its own milk. So this is very common in case of the Jersey cattle, and the lesions may be annular, angular, and erciform. So the classical therapy includes the antihistamines, sometimes the steroids, but one need to have a good control over the steroid treatment with a suitable antibiotic. Here you can see the milk allergy, entire body, the non-itching type of the, especially itching type of the wheels or over the shoulder or lateral thorax will be seen, and the neck and shoulder lesions are very common. Then the next disease is alopecia areata. So it's a autoimmune dermatological disorder, whereas the lesions may be especially the hair follicles, anagen hair follicles agents are the targets of the CMI and also humoral autoimmune responses. And you can see the pruritus and pain are not there, but the animals, otherwise they will be very healthy. Only a single animal in a herd is affected, whereas the in case of the mange, multiple animals are affected, and the treatment is very much symptomatic, like that of the administration of antihistamines, etc. Especially the multiple annular or oval type of this alopecia over the face and neck is seen. And here you can see that the annular areas of the alopecia on the head of this particular animals are seen. And many times the veterinarians may worry about the non-recovery of these animals, unresponsive. And this is, of course, one of the important lesions of the skin, food hypersensitivity, especially the feed which is containing the wheat, maize, soybeans, then rice bran, clay hay, then the milk replacers, especially in cows, cause generalized pruritus with or without the pustules. And bills. Very commonly, this is also one of the important disease. This cause commercial cattle feed induced lesions. So about this was a very big issues in Karnataka state about 10 or 15 years back. If they consume one type of the feed, they used to be affected with a very characteristic ascending type of the dermatitis. The role of the hexane or depatting the bran is also maybe one of the suspected culprit, and it will very well respond to the sulfur and zinc therapy with immediate withdrawing up of the feed. And many appreciate the lesions like this. It starts from the hind limb, then descends up to the udder. Of course, the buffaloes and cows are equally, they are affected, and lot of irritation or itching. And if you take the skin scraping from this particular animal, we'll get all types of the bacteria, secondary bacterial infections, and also the main infections will be seen. But this is due to the commercial cattle feed induced allergy, and it is attributed to the defatted rice bran, which is present inside the cattle feed as one of the allergic ingredients. So it will give a wonderful result. Immediately withdraw the affected feed and apply the sulfur plus zinc oxide paste on neem line for 10 to 15 days, and totally the animal is going to recover. So apart from this one, varieties of the environmental diseases are there. Then this is due to so many terminologies: intertiago, hematoma, teeth injuries, burns, frostbite, primary irritant contact dermatitis, ergotism, then fescue toxicosis, hyaloma toxicosis, and dermatitis pyrexia, then or the hemorrhage syndrome, and also the photodermatitis is seen. And apart from this one, many other causes like amanita toxicosis, arsenic toxicosis, then we can list them, starting from the chlorinated naphthalene, then hairy wedge toxicosis, iodism, mercurialism, mimosine toxicosis, wood, all these selenium, snake bite, then varieties of the subcutaneous emphysema, vampire bite disease. Of course, it is not present in our country, but in other countries it is present. And the intertiago, it's also known as the flexural seborrhea. What happens is it's a superficial inflammatory dermatitis caused by the different organisms. Especially it is retained in moisture and irritation from the accumulated debris. So immediately after calving, many cattle will get this thing. So the especially whenever there is a udder edema, which is said to be physiological one, there is a pressure between the thigh and the udder, and later it is causing, of course it is not non-pruritic and non-painful, but the Staphylococcus aureus or the Fusobacterium, they are causing a lot of problem here. The symptomatic treatment with the antibiotics and antihistamines is required, as mainly this is the udder, and in between the thighs, the such type of the very big lesions will be seen. They will never heal and always very wet and never respond to the regular antibiotic. This is called as the intertiago. So this is oozing and crustating between the udder and thighs. So many veterinarians have might notice it. Of course, it's sometimes it is multiple organisms may invade the fungus, because a lot of moisture will be present, and the fungus and the bacteria, and sometimes few virus will also affect and makes the disease unresponsive to the regular interval. So the ergotism, of course, it's a toxicity caused the Claviceps purpurea mycotoxins, and there will be especially alkaloids caused by the fungus Claviceps purpurea, and there will be gangrenous and sloughing up of the distal extremities, as this fungus is most abundant during the wet seasons, and the clinical sign begin after 7 days of exposure to the contaminated feed. And it includes hind limb lameness, fever, then poor appetence, and sometimes the non-specific clinical like the weight loss. As swelling begins at the coronary band, especially in the hind leg, and also the fat loss. So what we can see that such type of the lesions, a cut wound, and sometimes the necrotic spots are also seen, and clumping up of the distal limb will be seen in this particular disease. So the another thing is the photodermatitis, the it's called as the solar dermatitis or the actinic dermatitis. Then it is an inflammatory skin disease caused by the UV light. Whenever the exposed to the sunlight, then we can cause this is caused. And also the phototoxicity, it's also called as sunburn, very rarely seen in case of the white skinned animals. Of course, everybody knows about the primary photosensitization, especially some of the metabolically derived photodynamic agent which reaches the skin by ingestion. So this is caused by the hypericum perforatum, or the lantana camera poisoning causes the heterogeneous photosensitization, especially the phylloerythrin. It goes below the skin and causes the dermatitis. So the treatment is very much symptomatic. We used to use the antihistamines like especially the long acting antihistamines and the antibiotic whenever it is required. So here you can see that the photosensitization lesions, especially the lantana camera, which causes the dermatological disorder, like especially the eruptions of the white part of the body. Many might have observed such type of the lesions. And also the photosensitization, lantana camera toxicity. Yes, here you can see the eruptions of the entire skin. Sometimes the skin will peel off and leave a very big ulcerated mass. Of course, the treatment as usual, antibiotic and the antihistamines. And of course, the animal should never be exposed more and more to the sunlight. Always it should be tied in shade. Yeah, apart from this one, the erythema necrosis is also seen there, especially alopecia in the lantana camara poison. So very few of the toxicities. Of course, I am a toxicology man, and the selenium, iodine and chlorinated naphthalene only cause dermatitis in cattle, and the withdrawal immediately causes the recovery. So we need to identify the selenium toxicosis, remove the source, and immediately the animal is going to respond. So this is the chlorinated naphthalene toxicosis. Of course, the alopecia thickening and hyperkeratosis over the skin is seen. Then iodism. So yes, many times we are going to administer the potassium iodide or sodium iodide, 6 to 10 grams per 10 days. But if the dose is more, then the marked scaling and hypotrichosis and the dandruffs will be formed, and the sodium iodide or potassium iodide may be the culprit of this particular disease. So whenever we are administering such drugs, we should always see the toxicity aspect also. Yes, this is also the selenium toxicosis, alopecia, head and limbs, and sometimes the bent skin. So this is the seleniferous plants. If the animals are consuming, and they will get such diseases. Yeah, and last but not least, it is the nutritional causes, like the zinc responsive dermatitis will be seen when the true zinc deficiency. So it will be an idiopathic zinc responsive condition is there, and especially in certain areas where the zinc is deficient itself in the soil, the fodder will be deficient in zinc. And whenever we are not supplementing the zinc exogenously, then when we are using the calcium, iron, or phytates, and also the chelating agents for a long time, it may be causal. And simply supplementation of the zinc oxide at the dose of 5 gram per day for about 10 to 15 days will completely cure the disease. So this is the zinc responsive dermatitis. This is very similar to that of the food or the especially cattle feed induced dermatitis, but this is there the lot of itching will be present. Here the crust, thick crust will be formed, and alopecia over the trunk region will be present. There in fact, especially in case of food induced hypersensitivity, the back leg is affected, whereas here the front leg is affected, the parakeratosis. So the copper deficiency, and it is causing the spectacular appearance as spectacles around the eye. Lot of these alopecia will be seen, and we can see that the animal is wearing a spec from a long distance. So the copper deficiency, the faded hairs, normally back hair coat will be seen. Yes, of course, this is very common in case of the newborn calves. Many veterinarians might have noticed. This is the vitamin C responsive dermatosis. Especially immediately after calving, we can see that such type of the total alopecia, then this erythema, especially erythema, and the purpura of the legs will be seen, a very characteristic disorder, and the supplementation of the vitamin C in the form of the injection or also the oral, because the rumen is not well developed here, they will be responding to the oral vitamin C also. Then, of course, we can list miscellaneous skin disorders, they like vitiligo, and acrylic dermatitis, very similar to that of the dog and other things, furunculosis, then self-destructive behavior, sterile paniculitis, and telangon deflection is there. We'll see the vitiligo itself because many diseases. So vitiligo is an acquired defect of the body pigmentation characterized by the partial or the total loss of the melanin pigment from the skin. And molybdenum toxicity also it is seen, and copper deficiency are reported to be associated with the vitiligo. And very common in case of the buffaloes, and compared to the other animals, looks very odd. Especially the farmers try to sell the animal, but nobody is going to purchase the animal. And the causative agent is the copper deficiency and supplementation of the copper sulfate, 3 milligram per kg. For 50 to 60 days is very much required, and later we can see the characteristic recovery. This is the vitiligo, which is due to the coffer deficiency. So every day we can just administer about 5 grams of coffer for 30 to 60 days. Please see that the complete recovery occurs, and at the same time, there is a chance that some of the animals are highly susceptible to the copper sulfate is concerned, and the toxicity may also be there. So once the 30 days is over, then better to estimate the serum creatinine and also the AST and ALT, and later continue the treatment. So this requires 30 to 60 days treatment, and many times we'll see the complete recovery after the treatment is over. But always you should supplement the animal with the copper containing mineral mixture. So here also you can see that the copper deficiency occurs. Then in case of buffalo, this is very, very common. And you can see that before and after the treatment, which is reported by Gappert et al. In 2016. So here you can see the mouth lesions, then the animal is totally going to recover. Then neoplastic diseases like the papilloma, squamous cell carcinoma, fibroma, fibrosarcoma, hemangioma, mast cell tumor, then lymphoma, then melanocytic tumors. So here you can see that the papilloma is also known as, very commonly it is known as the VAPS. It's caused by the bovine papilloma virus. So there are at least 5 types of the bovine papillomavirus, BPV1 to the BPV5, and that causes the skin lesions and infectious, very infectious, follow direct or indirect contamination of the different wounds, trauma, ectoparasite, and also the ear marking, then vein puncture, etc. So the treatment is the papilloma. Nowadays, recently, so many papers are there, ivermectin, then podopilum toxins, then application of some of the, especially the drugs like the podopilum toxins and autoimmune therapy is also very effective. It is said that these are all the self-limiting, but many times it is not. So after the surgery also, we can also inject the lithium antimony thiamolate. It also gives a good result. And the recovery chances are less if we treat them with all these particular things are concerned. And here you can see that very big papilloma, these lesions are there, the entire body is affected. Then later stages, if it is got untreated, then it's very difficult. But later it is infected by the maggots, etc., then causes difficult. So nowadays, the recent papers say that the ivermectin is very effective. And but when the lesions are very, very big, somehow it is difficult to cure this particular type of the disorder is concerned. So always it is better to treat the animal in early stage, or else the surgery is made to be conducted, followed by the autoimmune therapy, lithium antimony thiamolate, etc. Then squamous cell carcinoma, everybody knows this is a tumorous mass. Then of course, the surgical extirpation is very much required for this diseases. So the especially whenever it is confused, if it is coming to the squamous cell of the eye, it is of course diagnosed properly. But if it is of the limb or some other types, then always surgical intervention is required. And the it is containing very large ulcerated mass with granular surface on the leg. It is very difficult to cure such diseases. Of course, after surgical removal also, there is a chance that once again it may reoccur. Then I want to give some message to the field veterinarians that many times it becomes very difficult task to diagnose and treat the bovine dermatological disorder. But the supplementation of this one, I think you can take this screenshot of this thing also. Suppose if it is available that sodium sulfate 30 grams, zinc sulfate or zinc oxide is very preferable, 30 grams, approximately one matchbox full. And of course the copper sulfate, because we have seen that in the copper deficiency also a dermatological disease is occurring, and 30 grams, just one matchbox full. Then ferrous sulfate as these 30 grams, then magnesium sulfate is required 1 kg because the absorption is poor. We have about 20% of magnesium in the form of the sulfate is affected. and a suitable mineral mixture which is containing the zinc and sulfur. It's very much necessary that the zinc and sulfur 1 kg. This is a what you call as the customized, very customized what you call as if any disease which is unresponsive to the routine treatment, but you cannot diagnose it, then the one should mix this thoroughly and store it in a cool place in an airtight container, because it's a hygroscopic in nature. Some of the times the magnesium sulfate or the sodium sulfate, they are hygroscopic in nature. They should be kept airtight container. Daily the dose is 20 gram, just one matchbox full for 15 days. Because of the presence of the zinc oxide or the sulfur sublimate, initially there will be a little oozing because it's a demulcent in nature. Then later the complete cure will be seen. So this should be as a sternal application. This is given orally, then solution of sulfur and zinc oxide, equal parts, especially 150 grams in 1 liter of the neem oil. Then you can apply it using the regular paint brush throughout the body for about 10 to 15 days. Most of the diseases, skin disorders, will be cured by this thing. Even though the animal leaks this particular thing, no toxicity is going to occur. So this mixture will give you a very good result, and you can try it. Of course, I'm coming to the conclusion part of this particular webinar is concerned, and many types of the dermatological disorders with the different etiologies. Of course, if you come to the end, we may forget the earlier thing also, so much confusing in there. And because of the skin disorders, the hide quality will be spoiled and cause a great economic loss to the farmer. The cause of the dermatological disorder need to be elucidated properly with the proper examination of the skin scrapings and also the lesion orientation. The therapeutic approach need to be followed properly based on the cause of the disease, because for everything, the ivermectin is not the solution. The few are the genetic in the important in disease. So one should handle the animal with lot of care, and also the owner who is attending the animal should also be warned about this particular thing is concerned. Then I thank you very much for waiting with me and being very patient about the past 50 minutes, especially 1 hour. And thanks a lot for ending with the sentence that if having the soul means being able to feel love and loyalty and gratitude, then animals are better than that of a human beings. The great veterinarian James Herriot has written, and my number is here 9448059777, and this is my email ID. You can contact me for any doubts, and now also I am ready to answer. Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, thank you, sir.
Actually, it is very interesting to hear that buffalo or cattle also having food allergy. It is very new to us, and we have seen similar cases in when we went for an investigation in Tanjore district. We have seen that aflatoxicosis affected plants, particularly leguminous plants. When it is raining, there is chance for getting aflatoxin because of decayed substance or anything which has fed to the cattle. They had also developed similar lesions like foot lesions, what we have shown in food allergy, and we have identified, and we have, once we withdrawn those feeding pattern, and we have gone for dry fodder and making them to expose with a healthy food, it become normal. So it is very, very interesting to hear that the commercial foods, sometime they develop, they also develop allergy in cattle. So that has to be borne in mind in our veterinarians. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sridhar, for taking us into a good journey of pharmacotherapeutics. Before I introduce questions from the audience, I have a few questions from my end. Today, most of the veterinarians like us have forgotten use of ointments which are pharmaceutical in nature, which can be made in the laboratory, made in the hospital premises, say a wide field ointment. So could you throw some light so that people remember that, so that they are able to use it, especially wide field ointment?
So especially in case of white field ointment, sodium salicylate and acetyl salicylate, especially and the benzoic acid, they should be mixed in proper quantity, especially if you want to prepare in equal quantities, 10 or 50 grams each in case of the Vaseline or the petroleum jelly, and we can apply it over the wherever the, especially the fungal, it is only effective especially in case of fungal disorders, because the especially the salicylic acid is a keratolytic in nature, and the benzoic acid is having antifungal activity and also the demulcent activity, means it will soothe the skin and reduce the irritation. So equal quantities, many times it may be very difficult to weigh each and everything. Then even if it's applied with the neem oil also, it's okay. If the liquid paraffin is not available, and about 50 grams of each in 100 ml of the neem oil, and it's it can be applied as a paste or the paintbrush, especially on the affected areas. What happens, sir, is usually whenever there is a bacterial infections or the viral infections, secondarily the fungus will be attacked because there is immunosuppression nature. So you are, yes, it's one of the cheapest method of treating the dermatitis in field condition is concerned, sir.
Thank you, sir. A few people are asking your number, so I put it in the chat box so that they can jot it down.
Yes, sir.
The next question is on estimation of copper deficiency. Does ceruloplasmin help in the deficiency confirmation of the deficiency? What happens? How do you diagnose deficiency of copper? Is ceruloplasmin having any role in that?
No, the copper deficiency occurs along with the this molybdenum toxicity. Whenever there is an imbalance between these two things, of course, there are many type of the enzymes and other things, but in the, it can be estimated there is a relation between that particular thing. But it is sometimes the estimation of the copper itself becomes a very difficult thing, because the atomic absorption, especially it's the this thing spectrophotometer required, and certain institutions where the research is going on, they are going to use this. But yes, of course, there may be a relation, but the field applicability part of all these things is limited to the laboratory at present. It's the academic research institutions, it's concerned, sir.
Sir, what is the dosage of potassium iodide in different conditions? Someone has asked in particular about actinomycosis. What route to be followed and how much to be given?
Yeah,
it's a pharmacology question rather than a dermatology question.
Yes, yes, maybe both pharmacology or dermatology, they should go together. This potassium iodide or sodium iodide, always it is better to go for the sodium iodide if it's available. Of course, the potassium iodide, sometimes what happens is if you go for the this, it's the dose of this particular potassium iodide or sodium iodide is the same, 5 to 10 grams per day, maximum 10 grams you can go for a minimum of 10 to 15 days. But if you see that the animal is suffering from some dandruffs or the crustaceans, etc., we need to reduce the doses, especially the potassium iodide. And many have got the habit of administering it as IV. So many times it's highly dangerous. Many times because of the potassium content, the animal may collapse. If you properly has not dilated it properly, diluted in especially 5% dextrose in 450 ml, it need to be diluted properly, or else if you inject it intravenously little slow also, the animal may collapse. So such preparations should not take the chance, and always it is better to give the potassium iodide or sodium iodide. Of course, the cost is also very high. The potassium iodide is costing about, the 25 gram is costing 700 rupees. Only 5 gram for maximum 10 days is recommended, and in between you need to stop that particular the drug for about 5 to 6 days, then it is necessary, especially in case of actinomycosis, it's very much required. The iodine supplementation is very much required, but one need to take a lot of caution while administering.
Sir, you have been treating number of cases directly and indirectly in being a pharmacologist. So any insight that you would like to throw on LSD?
Treatment, yes, of LSD. Yes, LSD, I think a lot of preview works, I think in Intas Polyvite itself has been published, and we are seeing that this is a rampant disease. But the thing is, there are two aspects. One is the antiviral property of the drug is also very important. But recently, many papers say that ivermectin is highly effective against the particular virus which is causing the, especially the goat pox virus. So the especially usually 0.01 microgram per kg body weight subcutaneously, usually 50, once in 15 days it's required. Two injections may be sufficient. It will take care of the virus as well as sometimes the wounds may be infected with maggots. That will also be taken care, and the further biting up of the flies may be prevented, even though it's not directly, but whenever they drink the blood from the injected animal, they may die and their population will be reduced. That's the number one treatment. And we may require the antihistamines sometimes if there is a lot of, sometimes the, especially if the initial stages of the lumpy skin disease, lot of itching is present. At that time, the administration of any of the antihistamines may be required for 3 or 4 days and followed by antibiotics. Sometimes if the, many times these animals always lick it and lot of ulcerated wound is formed. For that, the antibiotic may be required whenever there is a secondary bacterial infection. Whereas the external application is concerned, it is impracticable to suggest any of the ointments which are commercially available, or sometimes many of the ointments like the containing the chlorhexidine, this thing, chlorhexidine or some of the antiseptics may be efficient, but the painting it entire the body is one of the difficult tasks for the farmer. And the some of the herbal medications like the neem oil, and especially the neem, this particularly the fresh neem or neem leaves crushed with the tulsi or the curcuma longa, then if it is dissolved in 1 liter of the especially neem oil and painted over the skin, we have got very good results, especially in case of LSD. So initially, if you administer the ivermectin as the drug of choice, it takes up many things before the ulcerated wounds are formed. That will take care of.
Sure, sir.
Okay.
Your story of calculating 20 gram with one matchbox itself makes me remind of pharmacology. So
yes, sir.
One more question that we have is, you have been a very strong believer. There are questions on herbals, and I, with the last comment that you gave, it is that herbs do work. If you can throw some more light on that, people want to understand.
Yes.
Can
yes.
herbals be a treatment for dermatological disorders?
Surely, the dermatological disorders can, because it is a long-term treatment, usually 10 to 15 days treatment is required, especially in case of certain type of the dermatological disorders. So usually the skin disorders are always the cost effective, means the, it is not causing the immediate, this especially the farmers always, they will neglect the skin disorders, but they will not know what is the economic importance of this particular thing. We need to educate them, and the herbal treatment is sometimes the, especially the curcuma longa, which is having the antibacterial, anti-parasitic in so many activities, also the neem oil. Then the sulfur, especially sulfur is not the, the thing, but along with that of the allium, sativum, etc. It is effective. We have already tested in the, it in the lumpy skin disease, which has got a very good treatment, economical also. So all these herbs are available in the farmer's household itself, because we cannot tell any of the plants which are especially which are not abundant in the farmer's house, that we should not prescribe them also. So this curcuma longa, then neem leaf and tulsi leaf, all these are available in the far doorstep of the farmer. Only thing is, he need to procure the neem oil and make a mixture. Of course, I am telling the 100 grams, of course, a handful of these materials is very effective, because pharmacological activity is already well established, and we know the data. And I'm not advocating any of the things orally, because we do not know what are the pharmacokinetic because these parameters, drug interactions, the kinetics, etc. There is no harm in application externally of these things, and this will give a good result also in certain disorders like the lumpy skin disease itself. We have tested it, and it is having a very good effect. At the same time, economic also, the non-toxic also. At the if we apply dermatologic and over the skin, wherever the lesions are there, we can use it as a general line of the treatment also. There is no problem for it.
Right, sir. The last and the final question from my end. I have seen you diagnosing many a times toxicities, plant toxicities, and which are plenty in Karnataka actually, and yes, even in southern part. So, any tips that you would like to give to field veterinarians as far as diagnosing plant toxicities and their reflection on the skin?
Especially the plant like the Lantana camera, it causes the photodermatitis, because it is causing the secondary photosensitization reactions. So especially in case of the HF cows, they are the indiscriminate eaters. Whenever they are let out for the grazing, they are going to eat this particular plant and get the dermatitis or the photosensitization dermatitis. And sometimes the buffaloes, they are also infected, especially affected with the Lantana camera poisoning, and they are very susceptible to the Parthenium heteroporus, etc. So many times the entire skin will eruptated out. So whenever there is a scarcity season, such type of the dermatitis are seen. And many times if they are allowed to graze over this especially the market wastes, maybe I do not know, sometimes we are getting the skin eruptions, or sometimes there is a itching, etc. The vegetable waste should not be put to the animals. Sometimes they are having the goitrogenic effect, the dermatitis is caused. Of course, the mycotoxins, as you have rightly pointed out, sir, this Balasubramanian sir has rightly pointed out that yes, mycotoxins are also one of the cause of the dermatitis, because whenever there is a stale fodder is there, it may contain the minute quantity of the ergots, and also sometimes a minute quantity of the varieties of the mycotoxins. So many are there. So it causes the, especially the ergots, they cause the tail necrosis, ear necrosis, tail gangrene, all these are caused. So one need to be very careful, especially the mycotoxins goes unnoticed, even though, especially that's number one. Number two is the plant like the Mimosa invasiva, what I have studied, and of course, they are not causing the dermatological disorder, but it causes a characteristic disease like the perennial edema. Of course, we can keep it on some other day also, because the Western Ghats region, especially the Shimoga, Hasan and other districts in Karnataka state, they do contain a lot of the what you call as non-described plants, which are present in our routine textbooks. So it requires separate attention, especially it is regional based. In Assam, the same plants are not available, which are present in Madhya Pradesh. So we need to create a database on this particular plants is concerned. And sometimes the therapy is there, or sometimes it is not there, but we should be able to diagnose them properly. That's the dermatological disorders. Many times we have seen attributed to the plants also, like the Parthenium heteroporus. So the plant animals are going in and around the Parthenium. They will not consume it, but it is causing the primary this type of the dermatological disorders. So sometimes every day if they go on there, and then this becomes affected with the secondary bacterial infections. So such type of the things need the attention of the clinicians for the treatment, and such they need to be treated properly, sir.
I'll thank you on my behalf, and I'll take it request Dr. Nagaraj to summarize.
Yes.
Thank you, sir, for your energetic and very vast insight on bovine dermatology. It was wonderful for us to learn many things from you, and it should be a continuous one. You always be with us so that we all learn many things about bovine dermatology and also toxicology. So we on behalf of Indian Association for Veterinary Dermatology and INTAS Animal Health, we thank everyone who participated in this, and also Dr. Sridhar for this wonderful presentation. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for giving me the this opportunity to interact with the veterinarians and share my few experiences which are literature based. And also I'm thankful to our beloved friend, of course, I can say that, Dr. Nitin Bhatia, who is always associated with me and also yourself, sir, Balasubramanian sir, because you're the senior most veterinarian, and especially these dermatological disorders are very much neglected in field conditions are concerned. At least we should have the external diagnostic, means just symptomatic diagnostic also, that's also very much required. And I appreciate your the leadership, especially in the AVD, establishing the AVD, and it's a very wonderful effort, this effort, and also the INTAS is supporting almost all the events of the which are directly or indirectly concerned with the veterinarians are concerned. And thank you both of the institutions for your support, and in future also I am very delighted to be associated with you all persons, and I will be very happy, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you to all. We are closing the session.
Okay.